Good evening, everybody. I want to thank, as always, the show for putting up with us over here in their time and is allowing us to have these. I'll speak about why I chose this topic in a minute, but let me go through the preliminaries. And I'm going to start tonight. As you see, the name of the series is about Poland. There we go. As you can see, tonight's sponsor of the Freedman is Dr. Morris Freeman, honor, as he said, we have his brother Ira, who doesn't want me to say too much about him, even though he's one of the jewels of our community. I do want to say that I want to wish the Freedman family a great deal of refuah shleima, number one, of good health, and a lot of simcha in the coming year. And I just have a good feeling that good stuff is going to be happening to them. And in that spirit, I thank our sponsors, and I offer up a hope of all of us that what I just said will come true. Amen. So let's get underway. The name of this series, as you see, I call this Poline, which is what the Jews called it long ago, Poland. The Poles and Jews in 2018, trying to be friends, but prevented by different versions of a common history. I'm going to have to explain it as I go along. But I think everybody here probably knows that there's a lot of controversy going on right now between the Jews and the Poles. And Poland recently passed a law. They're not saying anything about the Holocaust now. They modified it because of pressure from Donald Trump and all that sort of business. And this was pushed by the right-wing Polish parties. So extreme right-wing Polish parties. So remember that term, the extreme Polish right-wing, because that's an interesting factor in Polish history. The extreme right-wing and the extreme left-wings are a pin in the neck in everybody's history, okay, including the Jews. We are now in the 3 weeks, and the second base of Mies was destroyed because of the extreme right-wing zealots long ago. That's what the Talmud tells you. So this will be a factor in what we're talking about as well. As you see, the first lecture tonight is entitled, How the Kingdom of Poland Became the Site of the Largest and Freest and Most Important Community in Jewry. So most people, when you talk about Poland, they think in an undifferentiated way about Eastern Europe and what's the difference between Poland, Ukraine, Lithuania. They all talk funny and they all look funny and all that. But it's not true, of course, right? Any more than to say, you know, the Americans, the Canadians, the Mexicans, all one thing. You know, it's not true. Every group has a very distinct culture. In Eastern Europe, that's really so. They have a bad history. Well, okay, that's the problem of being in Europe. It means you got bad history. That's why people came here and elsewhere and left Europe. But they have a long and a very rich history, and the Jews have been part of it for a long time. The reason I chose this topic is because I'm always looking for something for the 3 weeks that has a tragic nature. As soon as you think about the Jews in Eastern Europe, you're automatically invoking tragedy in connection with the Holocaust, obviously. What's really interesting now, I mean now, is that there are big fights raging in Eastern Europe, in these countries. Most of us don't even know about this, except specialists like my friend over there. And there are whole fights because they don't like the pass that they've been assigned. Hear what I said? They don't like the pass that they've been assigned. And they don't like the fact that how come the Jews' version of their pass gets out there and their Holocaust is acknowledged, but what happened to us is not acknowledged or not the way it ought to be. And different groups within the countries are, you know, playing on history themes. It's a land of lies, but, you know, I guess every country is to some degree a land of lies. That's why you have such bitter fights now, right now, in the United States of America, because the liberals, what they say is a lie to the right wing, and the right wing people, what they say is a lie to the left wing. That's how they look at it. When each one makes a speech or a point, the other side says it's a lie. So to get a common narrative is not so easy. And do not look for that so easily between Jews on the one hand and your Poles, your Lithuanians, your Latvians, your Estonians, the Belarusians, and all the other business, because they don't like the history that they've been, the role they've been assigned in history. And they're trying to argue against it. And none of you have an idea what I'm talking about. By the time it's over, I will have an idea what I'm talking about, at least as far as the Poles are concerned, I hope. So I found this interesting. As I said, there's a current fight going on Jews and Poles. It's not a fight that most Jews want to have. Bibi, as you know, the other day, in Israel made a whole speech. He said, okay, now it's over. Poland withdrew the law. They didn't really. They just said it's a civil penalty instead of a criminal penalty. But the state of Israel and the state of Poland actually need each other politically. And so for whatever reason, they say, you know, we want to put all this baggage in the closet and open it up later. We don't want to deal with this now, which is actually a very interesting kind of a situation. There are other countries in the Baltic where they have criminalized, criticizing the, I think, Lithuania, Latvia, some of those places. If you say that these people helped Hitler or something like that, or, you know, massacred Jews, you could go to jail. I know it sounds weird, but there you have it. And why? What's going on? So I'm only going to focus, as I said before, on the Poles, because Jews and Poles lived together in Poland for centuries. It's part of who we are. We're part of who they were. You know what I said? We're part of who they were. Particularly, they lived together in the fateful and disastrous 20th century, which was a bad century for the Jews, obviously, and a bad century for the Poles. Now, the Jews say, well, they killed 6 million Jews. That's Pasha, you know. What did they do to the Poles? Did a lot of bad things to the Poles. I don't say every Pole was a tzaddik. I don't say every Jew was a tzaddik. But they went through terrible times, as they see it. Because, to just put in simple terms, you had World War I, and you had World War II, and they had Stalin and the communists afterwards. It's not so simple, okay? So the 20th century has been a bad century, by and large, for both groups. Certainly the first half, first two-thirds of the 20th century. And now they're trying to get past it. Throughout these centuries, and even during the Holocaust, in my opinion, there have always been two sides of the poles, the Yetzer Tov and the Yetzer Hara. I'll say it again. For hundreds of years, if you study the record, at least when I study the record, you see a Yetzer Tov and a Yetzer Hara. The question for Jewish history is this: which Yetzer dominated events in which century, in which era in Poland? And you know me, to do this right, you got to go to the beginning. So, more or less, anyway. So here we go. Let's start with Poland. It actually starts not with Poland, but with the greatest empire in Europe in the 14th century. What was the greatest empire in Europe in the 14th century? Lithuania. You're laughing because we only know Lithuania is a small country. Look how big it was. That's Lithuania. This part, no, this is Poland. The Grand Duchy of Lithuania, once upon a time, was a gigantic place. Look, from the Baltic Sea almost to the Black Sea. It's amazing. Who would ever think? You know, the Lithuanians today are glad they have their Dalaramas. Look what they were once, okay? And Poland's smaller, correct? The Poles are smaller than Lithuanians, as you can see. So way back in the 1300s, the Jagiello of Lithuania, the prince, the Duke of Lithuania, who was a pagan, Ovid of Uzara, married Queen Jadwiga of Poland and founded a dynasty of kings, a long-lasting dynasty of kings of Poland and Lithuania. Notice, their children, it's like Ferdinand and Isabella was in Spain, you get it? He was the Grand Duke of Lithuania, that big country. She was the queen of the small country. And their children, therefore, were heirs to a joint throne, but mind you, two separate countries. So if you know anything about Spain, remember the Catalans not long ago tried to make their own country and get independence. That didn't exactly work out. Because they're tying it goes like this. Just because Ferdinand married Isabel doesn't mean it should be one country. Correct? Aragon should be Aragon and Castile should be Castile. So look how it works over here. In America, we don't even remember what happened last year. You couldn't tell me who was the governor of Maryland in the 1950s. And they can tell you who was the king in the 1550s. You see? So it's just, that's how history works in that part of the world. Each kingdom kept its own institutions and governments, and that's why it was a marriage of the century, okay? This was the start of a gigantic state, even though the state encompassed two sovereignties. So this area was what we call, I'll use the term Kingdom of Poland, but it's really the Poland and Lithuania, you know what I mean? So like Austria and Hungary again, like Castile and Aragon. There was two countries adjacent to each other. Most of the time they got along. Sometimes they didn't get along. They fought each other else, even though they had the same sovereign long ago. And generally speaking, though, it created a zone of internal peace and economic prosperity. Because when you have one general government over one area, and look at all the raw materials you got in Eastern Europe. the endless forests, the endless rivers, the mines of precious metals, all the good karka, the soil, the topsoil and all that business, just amazing amount of raw materials, so you can have prosperity, and they did. That's why the Jews went there. That's why the Jews went there. So I know we always think of Poland like in a black and white movie, but it wasn't. Their descendants ruled the king, meaning the Jagiellonian dynasty, ruled the kingdom of Poland and the Grand Duchy of Lithuania for 200 years. After 200 years, this dynasty died out because they had no kids. At that point, the nobles of Poland and the nobles of Lithuania got together and they hammered out, they negotiated what was called the Union of Lublin in 1569, by which both lands remained united but autonomous. So even though we don't have exactly the same king anymore for the dynasty, but we're all going to remain what they call a commonwealth, Again, like Austria-Hungary or something like that. For the next two centuries, so in other words, from the 1560s to the 1760s, the official name of the country was the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, the Res Publica Serenissima. Anyway, there's the Union of Lublin, a famous episode in Polish history. And it meant that in Eastern Europe, you could just have one big, large area, more or less the same. Local variation, but I mean, it's like one big empire, and they're going to be fairly well off, okay? Fairly powerful. One more point before we get to the Jews. A very important trend that developed during these centuries, in other words, the 1300s, the 1400s, the 1500s, the Jagiellonian kings, was the steady accumulation of power by the nobles. That was the big problem in Poland. They sucked up all the power. In other words, we're Americans and we're not used to this, but in Europe, it's a different reality. In most countries in the world, it's a different reality. There's a long tradition, not today, but long ago, for a long time, of an aristocracy, a titled aristocracy, maybe associated with land ownership, not necessarily, various ways, and the laws are different for these guys. So there's a privilege in the law. That's the way it was almost everywhere in Europe. And that's why people ran away to this country. That's the reason, okay, long ago. And they started a republic here, as you all know. What we have in America is rich and poor. But listen to the difference. If I'm rich and then tomorrow I'm poor, it doesn't mean the fact that I was rich before, it doesn't mean anything, okay? If you're the grandchild of a rich person, but now you're poor, it doesn't help. In European countries, if you're the grandchild of a noble, even though you lost your money, all the rest of it, you still enjoy these special privileges in society. For example, you're eligible for a government job, the laws treat you better, there are different rules of evidence, just a whole bunch of different things. You can't be an officer in the army unless you're a nobleman. It's not fair. It's what they consider fair. And they consider that the laws should reflect different fundamental classes of society. And there you have it. Now, in the case of most of your European countries, the nobles always tried to grab as much power as they could, naturally. The cities fought back. The church wanted a piece of the action. That sort of business. In Poland, it so happened that the nobles were very successful in their project, and they grabbed all the power. As I said before, Americans aren't used to this. Very famous episode, because Herbert Hoover's an American. And World War I broke out. He happened to be living in London. And the war was crazy and Belgium was starving. And Herbert Hoover was a private American, just organized on his own a whole international network to feed the Belgians. Which means, you can look it up. He raised money, he bought ships, he transported the grain from America. He had to negotiate with the Germans, he had to negotiate with the British, he had to get letters through the blockade, he had to deal internationally with all the governments. He had to organize nutritionists to figure out how to feed the Belgian people, the children should get, it's an incredible story. And the British were so impressed with him, even though they didn't like him, they said, if you'll join our side, we'll make you a member of the cabinet, we'll make you a duke. And minister of munitions, because when they had big trouble with the munitions, I can organize anything, you're amazing. And he said, I would never give up being an American citizen, that's higher than a duke. You understand? Forget it. That's an American sensibility. A European would say, are you crazy? You understand? You follow? It's a different. So for us in America, it's hard to connect with this. But that's how I went over there. And in Poland and Lithuania, it's a lot of people that fall in the category of the nobility. Not like in other countries, it's 10%. So imagine if you have a country of 5 million people, half a million people are nobles. That's a lot of people. Which means you could have somebody shining the shoes and he could have noble blood. He just happens to find himself in that situation. And he's treated by the law different than someone else. So the peasantry don't count. The city dwellers often didn't count, except in narrow circumstances. You know, to just get used to it. This was a big problem in Poland. But it was very good for the Jews. That's the point. It was very good for the Jews. So we begin the screwball history of the Jews and the Poles. Now, the nobility, the nobles, were a mass of little guys, they called the Schlachta, and a few biggies called the Magnates. And, you know, the Magnates own areas, farms as big as Rhode Island or bigger. I mean it, bigger. And the little guys might own a little, you know, control a little piece of land. There are lots of them, though, lots of them. And if we can get the movies up that I want to, you'll see the example I'm talking about. Slowly but surely in Poland, the Schlachta, the nobility, got more and more power until it was formalized in the Nobles' Republic, as they called it, in the 1500s and onwards. Only nobles could own land. They could only nobles can hold office. They're free of taxes. So they left that getting tagged. And they weren't going to get rid of all their privileges. You understand? They weren't going to do it. Many were small fry, but not in their little dalinama. So if a guy owns, if he's a nobleman, owns the territory of a little, this is my kingdom. You know, your home is your castle, as they used to say. And that was the reality of Poland. The Magnates, on the other hand, were epists. You know, I told you, they have gigantic holdings, some of them. You know, the Potockis and this and that and the other. It was huge. This is the weird reality in which the Jews will find themselves. The kings of Poland, therefore, were much less powerful. It's not so easy to be a king of Poland. They had some famous ones, but every one of them had a hard time trying to deal with the nobles and was pretty weak as it goes, because he couldn't raise a lot of money and get a big army because nobles don't want you to have an army. And what about the fact you have to fight the foreigners and you have to keep law and order in there? Like that. It'll go, you know. We'll manage. But the king shouldn't get too powerful. God forbid, after the Hegelians died, it shouldn't be that a father is followed by a son, because then they might really get too powerful. So what I'm trying to describe in general is that what happened in Poland is the opposite of what happened in the rest of Europe. And the rest of Europe, in these centuries, going back long ago, little by little, countries formed. And the way they formed is somebody called a king or a prince or something like that got more and more money and a lot of power. Then got a bigger army. And pretty soon, you know it, he's the king of France. There was a time when the king of France was not the king of France. But then things changed and he was the king of France. And he makes the laws and he makes this. And the army's under him and the nobles better listen. You know, it's never exactly a dictatorship, but it's close to it. That didn't happen in Poland. That's the point I'm going to get across. That did not happen. So basically, if you were a nobleman, Poland was a wonderful and great place. If you were not a nobleman, it was a lot more complicated. Okay? It's a lot more complicated. Under this Republic of Nobles, the main action took place at the parliament, or the diets, as they call them, the same in Polish. So the nobles say, we'll run what's going on in this area, and we don't need the king and the other people to tell us. We can do it just fine ourselves. These diets were elected by local little diatines. So basically, this small area, they get together and elect a tiny parliament. They send delegates to a higher parliament. They finally get sent delegates to the central parliament. So the king is just he's not a figurehead, but he was not really so powerful. And anyhow, only the nobles can vote. Now, the Jews of Poland who moved into Poland copied this system. That's the reason I'm telling you all this. The Jews copied this system. You've heard of the Vada Abrahamsis. It's nothing but the system that I just told you, adapted for Jews. Instead of calling it a diet or the same, they call it a vod. The local vods elected delegates in a national vod, paralleling the goyim. So maybe you've heard, some of you have heard, that in Poland they had a central council, sort of all the Jewish communities. Imagine if you had that in America. I mean, for real. Not the federations, which is a joke. I mean, for real. Then it would be just an interesting situation. They could pass takanas, they could pass laws. It's never clear exactly how much power they had at one time or another, but it looked impressive, at least. It's like the Jewish parliament. The Vod of the entire Polish Commonwealth was called the Vada Abrahamsis, the four parts of Poland. In other words, the Jews tried to create a system of coercive autonomy to the degree possible. That's what Jews do, in the old days anyway, the old autonomous coercive kehillahs. They figured the Polish nobles would understand, and the Polish nobles didn't understand. They said, we got one, so they kind of, the Jews have one. I mean, you know, not that they get in our way. If they do that, it won't work. But if they don't get in our way and they want to just run Jewish things, regularly Jewish marriage, Jewish divorce, Jewish jails, and all that kind of business, so let them do it. That's how they do. So the Jewish equivalent of the nobles of the Shlachta were, we don't have an actual aristocracy in Judaism, the rich. Okay? And they were the Yichas. Get it? So in Poland, in Eastern Europe especially, if somebody was poor but the grandfather was somebody, Ich bin Epis, you know, I am something. They call it the Hasidim, call him Benon Shal Kadoshim. You know, I'm the great grandson of such a Rebbe. An American will say, and, you know, but in Europe, they'll say, like this, you get to the head of the line, you see? Okay? So the Jewish equivalent of the Shtachta were the rich. However, since Polish Ashkenazic Jewry brought with them strong traditions of scholarship and Chashivas of Limud Torah, because as we'll see in a minute, the Jews who came to Poland came there from somewhere. Where'd they come from? And the answer is Ashkenaz. So they started out in France, then they were kicked out of there and moved to Germany, and then were kicked out and they moved to Poland. So the Jews who are moving to Poland, the most important elements anyway, come with a long tradition, going back to Rashi and people like that. And in that culture, one of the equivalents of money is learning, one of the equivalents of money. It's like that, you know, but there you have it. Now, therefore, the big rabbis were also considered part of the nobility, the big rabbis. And just like the high Catholic churchmen were part of the Polish nobility and played a role in the diets. Just as the diets had to run on the consensus, so did the vods. And therefore, it's just interesting to see the Polish Jews, Polonized, as the word goes, to some degree or another. Now, in all this crazy talk I'm talking about, Poland actually had a renaissance. You had Copernicus and people like that running around. In the 1500s, Poland had universities, if I remember correctly, way back. There were universities in Poland before there were universities in Germany, believe it or not. Kind of like Krakow, place like, it's not what you think, okay? People saying, you know, Poland is like a backward country, all the rest of it, it's not exactly true. They have a very long Western culture, Latin and all the rest of it. Now, the question, of course, is like this. I was gonna show you Copernicus, you know, who was Polish, right? In the 1500s. It's not like he had to go, you know, somewhere else to learn math and astronomy, you see? Now, how do the Jews fit in all this? That's the question we're interested in. How do the Jews fit in all this? As I just told you, by the year 1500 or so, the Ashkenazic Jews had been kicked out of everywhere else in Europe. They started out in France, and they spread a little bit in England. Then they were kicked out of England in 1290, kicked out of France. I mean, literally kicked out of France in the 1300s. And then they were in Germany, what they call the Holy Roman Empire. Over the course of the 12, 13, and 1400s, I've said this many times, the Jews were de facto kicked out of Germany because you either had a pogrom in this area and they would just kill everybody, you know, some crazy thing happened, or you'd have them being expelled legally by some prince, or they think there was some kind of blood libel situation and kill them or kick them out of that. Or, you know, the competition with the local businessmen and they kill him or kick him out over that, or you have some kind of a plague. And so, if I had one of these interactive maps, you'd see a map of German states in the 1200s, 1300s, 1400s, and you see, you know, flash here, flash there, flash there, flash there. It's always something bad for the Jews. And what it means de facto is that by the time you get to 1500 or so, more than 95% of Germany was no Jews. More than 95% of Germany. More than 95% of Germany. Because in each place, the Jews have been expelled or killed. And that's how it went. So where'd they go? So some hung around. Some German Jews, they just continued to live there and took all the garbage. But a lot of people saw like this, the heck with this, I'm moving to Poland. Moving to the next country over. Which was a big country, as you just saw, and was prosperous. And most important, they let the Jews in. Most of the countries in Europe by 1500, I'll say this again, most of the countries in Europe, 1500s, had it up to here with the Jews. The second half of the Middle Ages in Jewish history is characterized by the expulsion of Jews from Europe. Like I said before, you can do the years in 1290 England and 1350 something in France, and as we all know, 1492 in Spain, And Germany, I just told you over here, and the Dutch never let them in the first place. The Scandinavians never let them in the first place. The Russians never let them in the first place. Hungary kicked them out also in the 1400s. I mean, you can go line by line. And same thing in Italy. It was not fun. So if you want to be very technical, by the time you get to 1500, there's a few, 1500 or 1510, there's a few in the German states. There's a few in the Italian states. And that's about it. There are none in the Spain and Portugal. There are none in France and England, right? None in Scandinavia and Northern Europe. What else he got left? None in Switzerland. The Swiss kicked him out in the 1300s. So you go like that, it's Poland. So first of all, the fact they let him in with no quota, speaking of current politics, is remarkable. And second of all, the Jews came there, found they were able to make a living. And it fit into the economy. And so by the time you get over here to the 1500s, you can say Jewish history really starts a significant way in Poland. So now it's the year 2018. So let's say the last 500 and some years. That's a long time. By the 1500s, I just told you, who were the real bosses in Poland? The nobles and the magnates were the ones who counted, nobody else. So whatever the urban dwellers thought of a Jewish influx, and I'm sure they disliked it. I mean, we know. You know, people in Krakow and you know, and Lublin, these kind of places, they didn't like these new people showing up and being competitors and quote-unquote opening up to a grocery store, several, I mean, the equivalent of that. They don't count. The king, who's a noble himself, and the nobles count. Their opinion counted for nothing. And the Jews were able to make the case that they can be of economic utility to the nobles. And they were. And that's what happened the next 400 years. Okay, that's how it worked. In Poland, these nobles, as I said before, were like little kings in their own domain, especially the big ones and the magnates. And if they don't pay much taxes, all the rest of it, basically your attitude is, this farm of mine, or this 20 miles of mine, is my kingdom. So I'm going to run it in the best possible mercantilistic way to make money out of it. And the Polish nobles were intelligent people, but they're not going to go and do manual labor. And so what they did was they allowed into the country different ethnicities that have a history of economic networking. I always say like this. If you look around today, there are certain ethnic groups that just have a tendency for commerce and others that don't. So you see Korean grocery stores. You see Pakistani 7-Elevens. You go around the world, the Chinese are always involved in some kind of business situation. This Chinese colony here, Chinese colony there. You don't really see, as far as I can tell, Argentine, commercial networks. Okay? You don't see, Namibian networks, Swiss. But you do see Greek, Korean, as I said before, Arabs. Certain ethnicities, Jews. So if you went back to the 1500s, the ones that came to Poland, you had your French, your Scottish, your Italians, your Greeks, Armenians, and Jews. I think that's it. These are just people, Germans too. They're coming there and one helps the other, like they do, and they set up little networks, informal, and they, make themselves at home in the business climate. So as far as the Polish nobles are concerned, it goes like this. I'm a nobleman. I have a big estate. I want to turn it into cash. How do I do that? So maybe a Frenchman or German will come in and say like this. We can chop down all the lumber and sell and move it down the river over here and sell it for some country that needs it for warships. And so here are the numbers, okay? And what's your profit margin? You make 50 and I make 50. And then comes the Scottish guy and he's like this. I'll tell you what, I'll take 40. You see? And then comes the Armenian, he says, I'll take 30. And by the time it's all over, the Jew says, I'll take 5% or something like that. Yeah, no, that's what it was. And nobleman is not dumb. And meanwhile, the Jew, first of all, needs anything he can get. Second of all, he made a niche in the market. You know? Next time I'll make 6%. You follow? And this happened all over the Polish Empire. And consequently, Jews, I'm talking about the more wealthy Jews, created large business situations by making themselves of service to the nobles. You got all this land and a lot of grain, And right now the grain market is overstuffed and not much you can do with it. Well, let's turn into vodka. Where are you going to sell the vodka? You can sell so and so much locally. It can sell so and so much in this country, because I have the cousin, Shmerel Barrel, in Bohemia, and he knows that this will go over well over there. Now, the Frenchman's also got a cousin, but the Jew will take a smaller piece, you know, and leave more for the noble. So if you just widen this to be grain, to be whiskey, to be lumber, to be iron, salt, you know, all this kind of business, it's an economy, isn't it? And so the Jewish people came there. And the ones I'm talking about were better off. There are others as well, as we'll talk about. And they were of service to the people that counted. And nobody else mattered. The urban dwellers, the Polish intellectuals, they didn't like it. But so what? And Bnei Yisrael, part of Vayishur Tzu, Vayir, Vayatsu, Vatim Alei Arz, or something. It's exactly what happened. And Poland, this large kingdom that I'm talking about. So when I say Poland, I'm talking about the kingdom of Poland, which no longer exists. The kingdom of Poland that I'm talking about included what you call today Poland, and Belarus, and Ukraine, and Lithuania and Latvia, maybe even Estonia. So that's a big area already. So it doesn't mean the little Poland that you see on the map now. It's the Poland of yesteryear. And to be, again, to be technically exact, it's the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. But that's one big area in which you can do business. You understand? And that's what the Jews did. Now, it's interesting, because what really happens by the time it's over is that the Jews come there and they have to compete against other ethnic groups, and they win the battle. It doesn't happen overnight, it happens about 150 years. It means you're constantly competition. After a while, the others just give up. By the time you get to the 1700s, the Jews are control, under the control of the nobles. So I always like this story. Yeah, that's already, that's I was saying before, not the, this was a very great king of Poland, Stefan Batory. He was a very powerful king, but he had a hard time running the country because of the nobles. Let's go to the next one, if we can. We talked about him. Let's go to the next one. Yeah, you all heard of, if you're my mother's age, you heard of Graf Potocki. Well, this is Graf Potocki. Right? Potocki was a giant family. I've told the story many times, but just to give an example of what I'm talking about, in the 1700s, the town of Brody, which he owned, burned down because Mrs. O'Leary's cow fell over and everything was made out of wood and everybody was wiped out. All the merchants were wiped out. I mean, wiped out. And the merchants went to the castle of Count Potocki, who was the owner of everything over there, I mean, literally, and he gave each guy $100,000 cash. I'm talking about Jews. There were like seven or eight Jewish businessmen, seven or eight Jews. And why did he give them $100,000? He wasn't in love with the Jews. That's an understatement. But he was an intelligent steward of his own economic interests. If I give a drunkard $100,000, what's he going to do with it? He's going to blow it in a weekend, right? If I give a business person $100,000, what are you going to do with it? You're not going to go to a fancy restaurant. What's a business person going to do with $100,000? You're going to invest it in something. So these people were merchants. They were tried and true businessmen. They just suffered a reverse because a fire broke out. Okay, they lost everything. When he gave them that kind of money, they went right away to Leipzig in Germany where they had all the big fairs. They had cash in hand. They bought a big ton of merchandise. They had it transported back. It took about 2-3 years, and the town of Brody was rebuilt on its own, double the size, and the, what should we call it? The merchanting, what am I thinking of? The trade, the commerce. You won't believe this. They traded with China, and they traded with Connecticut in the 1700s. That's how big they got. So did Potocki ever ask for his money back? He's a smart guy. He don't have to ask for his money back. He got his money back manyfold because the place grew and developed into a major commercial center, and they had the rivers and the wharves and employment and this and that and the other, and he got his off the top, and he did it very well. So this just gives you an insight into mentality of these nobles who were not dummies at all. We're not dummies at all. Bottom line, as far as the Jews are concerned, the Polish nobles constituted the Yetzer Tov of Poland during these centuries, even if they did it out of narrow self-interest. The fact is that Poland and its empire became the best Gaulis. Even if bad things happened from time to time by capricious nobles. And that's why the Jews called it Polin. Here we find the resting place. Right? It's a play on words, of course. But Poli means here we can rest. And because if you know what was going on at that time in the 15, 1600s, in Germany, in Italy, in France even, and other countries, even in Turkey, where the Jews had it fairly well, they were treated with extraordinary contempt by the person on the street. You had a better physical situation living in the Kingdom of Poland, even though most people don't realize that. But a couple years ago, I did hear the Gzeres Tachvatat, if you remember, the Chmelnytsky massacres. And if you read the memoirs of Jews lived at that time, especially the Yavei Metzula, even idealize it a little bit, the Jews had it good, and particularly because it was a perfect storm. And the perfect storm was that the Polish nobles wanted them there, but they didn't want them to be part of there. Okay? You're not Polish. And so don't interfere in our culture and, you know, keep to yourself. That's what the Jews wanted. They're Ashkenazic Jews. They're Ashkenazic Jews. What do they want? Their idea of an ideal situation is to have a place in the village or the town, which is all Jews, and you don't have anything to do with the Polish business. And on the other hand, you cultivate a very heavy and very intense interiority. And therefore, Poland became a very Jewish kind of a culture area. Culturally and religiously, I said before, that therefore the Poland and the Ashkenazic Jews hit it off because of this weird storm. But that's what happened. And, you know, the guy basically said, you're here, but you know, you're seen when you're seen, when you're not seen, when you're not seen. And, you know, keep your own business. They expected a Jew to read a Jewish book. They didn't expect to read a Polish book. You see? And the Jews wanted it that way. At least the rabbis and the rich people did, and therefore everybody got along great in that particular regard. So though born of illiberal motives, the Jews were freer to practice a full-blooded Yiddishkeit than anywhere else. Isn't that funny? Okay. It's not because of Thomas Jefferson principles, there was none of that, and not because of the rights of man, or everybody's entitled to freedom of their own, because of this weird situation. But the Jews says like this, who cares? Especially the Ashkenazic Jews of old. You're Bubby's Bubby's Bubby. You know what I mean? From long ago. Who cares what the reason is? Is it better than you find in another country? There's a famous Ramo. The Ramo who wrote the Shulchan Aruch lived in Krakow, in the Jewish ghetto of Krakow. When I say the Jewish ghetto, I should say the gated community, Kazimierz. You know, the Jewish neighborhood. Okay? And which was such a separate part, then on the get, they would write, you know, this is done in Kazimierz, not in Krakow. Like in Baltimore, you say, this get is done in Forest Park, you see? You know, that kind of thing. So he had many students. He was a famous rabbi in Rosh Hashiva. And one of his students is a very well known. Was looking for a job, and he got a job as a rabbi in Germany somewhere, in South Germany. And he wrote to the Ramo to say, I got a stellar. And the Ramo wrote him back. He said, listen, I'm glad you found a job, and I wish you good luck, and I like you all the rest of it, but that ain't for me. I'd rather have a dry crust of bread in Poland without the anti-Semitism. Now, Poland was a fairly anti-Semitic country, but it just goes to show you, nothing compared though elsewhere. So somebody living in Krakow, which is near the southern border of Poland, would say, ooh, Baruch Hashem, we don't live in Austria, but I mean, one of these type of places where it's like toxic. Here is just regular anti-Semitism, you know, like that. So it's a funny situation, but there you have it. And that's why, let's go to the next picture. All the famous rabbis you've heard of, these are a few, are from Poland in the 1500s, 1600s. The people in the back of the Gemara, on the front of the Shulchan Aruch, all the rather, here's the Ramah. They're not actual pictures, but they're the pictures that they put out in these books. You know, so that's the Ramah, that's Masi Nataz, I think that's the Marashah. No, it's not the Shah. Yeah, maybe it is. And this is supposed to be our show. That's the Maral. Meaning, all these names you hear about, each one you say, who is he? What is he? Well, he lived in Poland in the 1500s. Who's the Bach? Oh, he's a rabbi in Poland in the 1500s. You know, who's this one? No, he's a rabbi in Poland in the 1500s. To the point that the American gets bored. You know, like, is it what else to know? Yeah, but it's true. So how come you have all these rabbis that wrote all these commentaries and books and this and that and the other? Because you could. You see? There wasn't even a big censorship. In Germany and Italy, by this time, you wanted to publish a book under the aegis of the Catholic Church. It was a bummer gadol. They went through every word you wrote, and they excised things right and left. In Poland, it didn't happen that way. It's really interesting. Now, as I said before, There's a famous sefer written in the time of the Cossack massacres of 1649-1650, Yevhen Metzula, in which he said, if you ever came to Poland before the Cossacks showed up, it was a Gan Eden. You had Torah, you had Avodah, you had Milos Chasanim, every town had yeshivas. He says every town had yeshivas. Every town had at least 30, 40 people that had smicha. The Jews had synagogues. They had an organized system of chesed. He says there was a national women's committee that made sure no girl made it to 18 without getting married. You understand? And he writes all these sorts of things. And when they had the meetings of the Vada Barotzas, or once or twice a year they would get together, like on Pesach time, it was like, I'll make myself look silly, but if you're of a certain age, you'll know what I mean. It was like, imagine a from Atlantic City. You understand? Because everybody, all the Jews show up in this, and he says, and they were covered Malachim, and all the yeshivas came there, and it was like Shidduchim City, and that's where boys switched yeshivas at that time. And they had a whole system where the whole Poland learned one Masechta. You know what I mean? They had a coordination. So from that narrow Ashkenazic point of view that we call today yeshivish, because that's what yeshivish is. It's the Ashkenazic Polish culture. That's what yeshivish is. I won't say a word paradise, but it was a paradise. You understand? In that regard. So usually you don't think of Poland this way, but they had it pretty good. Now, therefore, under noble protection, the Jews assumed a definite niche in the Polish economy and even in the Polish lifestyle, and they became a part of Poland of yesteryear. I mean, a basic fundamental part of Poland. First, you had the Arendars. Let's go to the next one. Look at this. Here's an old picture, I think from the 1400s, if I'm not mistaken. And it's every different type of Polish person over there. One's a noble, one's a doctor. Here's a Jew. A Jew. All right? It's part of the scenery. You don't have a Polish town without some Jews. You get it? You like it, you don't like it. It's part of the scenery. I don't think you'd have this in an Italian woodcut. And you had your merchants, of course. Jewish merchants. Every time you have a Jewish merchant, they have what you call the Av Israel, his brother, his son-in-law. No. They're the agents. They're the brokers. They're the accountants. They're the bookkeepers. They're the schleppers, the kleppers, the one they send over here, there. Every time somebody set up a business, you're talking about employing a bunch of people. Who are you employing? You get it? You're good-for-nothing son-in-law, you know. That whole thing. All these typologies come from that kind of a world. So you had those people. The Arendars would be the people who had a contract with the nobleman, you know, to have the right to sell the salt over here or to collect the taxes or something like that. Then you have your regular merchants. These guys are the ones who backstopped the famous German Jews, the Kriegsjuden, the Hofjuden of the 16th and 1700s, which means that, I think we talked about in the past, one of the interesting features of European life long ago was that a lot of countries, the king, the ruler, the emperor, had a Jew. Even if they didn't allow Jews in there. Why do they have a Jew? To do certain activities for him. What is the main activity? Supply the army. What do you mean supply the army? That requires a certain level of organizational skill. Let's say you have an army, like the King of France or something like that, with 40,000, just for argument's sake, 40,000 men. That's 120,000 meals a day. How you do that? You got your horses. How much oats is that two or three times a day? The army's got to have so-and-so many buttons, so-and-so many hats, so-and-so many cannonballs, so-and-so many and this and that and the other. I mean, who does that, right? They didn't have cars in those days. How do you do that? And the answer is that these are contracted out. And over the course of time, it's really remarkable, especially after the second half of the 1600s, and second half of the 1600s and 1700s, you see over and over again what they call these Jews, who are the ones who are the quartermaster generals, if you want to use the term, for the army. Every German prince has like a Jew. The Holy Roman Emperor, who hates the Jews, the Leopold I, has a bunch of Jews, Oppenheimer and Wertheimer and people like that. It was a big battle. Even the Turks have like that. It was a big battle in 1717 between the Austrian army on the one hand and the Turkish army on the other hand, near Belgrade. Prince Eugene was very famous. Each army was supplied by their Jews, famous rabbis. You understand? You're going to live. Who was the one supplying the Turkish army in the battle? The Mishnah Melech, Yehuda Razanis, because his family, they had the monopoly to supply the army. How does somebody supply the army? How do you actually come up with 120,000 meals a day? How do you come up with 100,000 bullets or 250,000 bullets and cannonballs and things? How do you do that? The answer is what? The person at the top has to organize. How do you organize that sort of thing? Well, here we go. Here comes Poland. I need so and so many meals a day. So that means you need a lot of grain and a lot of fodder for the horses. So I'm living in Germany, but I have a cousin who lives near the Polish border, and he has a friend who has a cousin who lives in Poland. That guy works for Count Potocki, and the other one works for Count Czartoryski, and they've got lots of grain. And it's a matter of business. You know, if the numbers work out, and supply and demand, and you tell this cousin, who tells Shmerl, who tells Beryl, all the rest of it, I want to buy up every piece of grain in this province now for this season. And tell your other friends over there, you know, Mordechai and Shmordechai and Kordechai, that they should buy up all the grain over there because we have a market for it. The market is the King of France or the King of Sardinia or the Grand Duke of Baden or something like that. You see? And same thing when it comes to making iron. Here's where the iron ore is, and there's a place in Germany where they manufacture it. But I know Ira Friedman has all the contacts with the iron ore people, and Shmerl Friedman has the contact with the German people, and then it's got to be transported over here. And that's how they did it. It sounds like I'm making fun of it, but it's really remarkable that all these military campaigns were on the supply end run by Jews. That's what they call the Hofjuden. And it was all backstopped by these Polish guys who can deliver the material, deliver the goods. You go to Count Potocki, I have great news, there's a war in Italy. And that means, remember all those extra fields we didn't know what to do with? You'd sell it all top dollar. You see? You know that extra forest we didn't know what to do with? You now make a mint. Because the Queen of England is having a war with the King of France, and the Navy is going to build it, and the kind of wood you have is a good wood, and so on and so forth. This is how life was done once upon a time. Then, of course, aside from these guys who are serious, wealthy people, you have the natural handlers and hawkers of the flea markets, right? Because everywhere in Poland you have a shuk, you have a market. I call it a flea market because in America you call it a flea market. Over there it's a regular market. And we have descriptions. Towns where your parents, grandparents, great-grandparents came from had markets once upon a time. And before the Russians showed up and messed everything up, there's a new book about it, actually. In the old Poland, it was something along the lines of a free market, and therefore everybody's hawking and handling all the time. How do you make a living? The average Jew, what he does is, he says, what's for sale? He says, I heard there's beeswax over here, I can sell over there at a profit. Right. Then he goes over there, meanwhile, he finds out there's extra ladies' skirts he brings back over here. Then he finds out there's hosiery, he can sell it over here. And a week later, you find, there's pig bristles, and you sell it over here because there's some people that want that. Then you find that, you understand, those are never one thing all the time. And every family, let's put it this way, this is the origin of the famous joke we all heard, Nishkiret Av Shabbos. Because one long ago, if you went in Poland, whether they should or they shouldn't, as soon as they got into the shul, everybody's saying, I saw this, we could do this, that, and the other, And you're not supposed to do it on Shabbos, but it happened on Shabbos, Shabbos, Kiret. That's how life was lived. And it was fairly prosperous. That's the point I want to get across. If not for invasions and wars and junk like that, it kind of worked. You understand? Some people have hand to mouth, some people have this and the other, but the country was full of resources, and the food was there, and the stuff to buy and sell was there, and that's how a lot of people made their living. And culturally, the most famous of these is ubiquitous taverns, okay? Because there's actually a book that came in no longer about it. I'll show you the cover. All the bars are owned by Jews. What do I mean by all the bars are owned by Jews? The bars are always owned by the noblemen. That's a basic monopoly the nobles insist on. Because it's an easy way to make money. It makes sense to me, right? What's one of the major sources of revenue for the United States government? Booze. True or not? How did FDR, here's a question for your thing, how did FDR finance the New Deal? Because they got rid of the prohibition, and then the revenue came in from the booze. Okay, that's what they found out. So, like it or not. So, When it comes to Poland, when you got all this vodka, because you have all the grain, you can turn into vodka. All the grain can turn into vodka. The nobles naturally selling this. We have monopoly on this, no stills, you know, we're the only ones that do it. But I'm not going to do it, I'm going to get somebody to do it. He's not going to get a Pole or Ukraine to do it, they'll drink up all the goods. Jews don't drink. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but the culture was, the Polish nobles also, like, the Jews not going to drink up the thing. If they take a l'chaim once in a while, that's not what we're talking about. In Eastern Europe, that's not called drinking, you know? He says, the Jews don't drink, they call the rite of propination. And that, and it was a basic part of the national culture. And anyway, wherever you went throughout Poland, wherever you went, I wasn't there, but you know, a lot of places you went throughout Poland, it's a piece of land, the nobleman of some sort or other is owning it, and there's a peasants around there, and there's one bar. But it's not a bar, it's a tavern. There's a tavern in Poland, I don't even know what the right word is. It's because it is a bar, it's also 7-Eleven. No, I'm serious. It's also Best Western, I am serious. It's a post office, what else? You know, it's like four or five other things. You get it? It's a restaurant, okay? Now, an American would like to go in there. If you ever read the descriptions, Jeremy Bentham was once traveling through Poland, the famous English philosopher, and it was the middle of winter, and he stepped inside the bar. Woo! He said, I'll sleep in the coach. You know, I'll take my chances with the wind. But if you have a strong nose and a strong stomach, that's how life was lived once upon a time. Wherever you go throughout Poland, is it you? I'll show you a movie in a minute. You'll see. You know, talking about Polish movie, Gleisha movie. Okay. Look at that. These are Polish paintings. Who's playing music? That's another place. Is this? It's also a swing show. You know what I mean? No, I mean it. I'm serious. They don't have a jukebox. They have a Jew. I know you're laughing. I know it's funny, and I said it for that reason. But it's actually true. So here are the Poles, right? And he's actually dressed fairly nice. So it's most likely a Sunday coming home from church, right? Or maybe a chasana. I'm serious. Might be a Polish wedding. And what you do at the wedding is afterwards you come into the place over here and you order rounds and all the rest of it, and he is making the money and giving such and such a percent to the nobleman. You get it? Well, obviously he's trying to squeeze as much out of him as he can, and that's how life was lived for thousands and thousands and thousands of Jews. This is where it comes to Mechiras Chametz, because all these Jews, when they came to Poland, encountered for the first time in Jewish history booze. Am I right or am I wrong? In Mediterranean countries, you have wine. There's no whiskey. In the Talmud times, in the Bible times, you have wine and beer from dates. What did the Jews know in their history up to before the 1500s? Brandy, cognac, it's all from wine. You understand? Maybe vermouth, things like that, I don't know. Real liquor, they encounter in Poland. That's encountered in Poland. And not only encountered in Poland, they sell it. So it used to be that Mechiras Chametz on Pesach was not so difficult, but when you came to, because you just make sure, like many of you do, to get rid of all your chametz by Pesach time, more or less. You know, an intelligent Akeres Habayis can figure out how to do that. But not if your whole stock is barrels of booze. You know, what do you do with that? Therefore, they had to come up with the whole idea of Mechira, and you're not transferring it and not moving it. But anyway, the first thing they tried to do in 1500s halachically was to see if you can make an argument, al pi din, that whiskey is not chametz. There were rabbis that did that, but the Ashkenazic sensibility didn't feel, they felt like a guilty conscience, that's cheating. It's interesting, you know, you see from here what the religious conscience is. But selling it through, like we do, that they felt okay with, those that did. See, by the way, let's go to the next one. This is from a book by Professor Glenn Dinner, came out not long ago, called Yonkel's Tavern, in which it's a whole study of what I'm just talking about over here. And I know what he's talking about. I mean, he says over here, Yonkel's Tavern is a very famous scene in Polish literature. As I'll show you in a minute, the most famous, or one of the most famous, I'm not an expert in Polish literature, I'm not. Professor Shapiro might be, he says, but Mickiewicz, you know, this like a, what shall I say, like a Shakespeare almost, a Poland. And in the 1800s, a non-Jew, one of the most famous, there are statues of him everywhere. And his most famous epic poem is Pontadius, you know, about Lord Thaddeus. It's a whole business. They made a movie out of it. And it's extremely well known. And one of the places things happen, as I'll show you in a minute, because they made a movie 20 years ago in Poland, Pan Tadeusz. One of the places things happens is in Jankel's Tavern. I mean, the local Jew, who actually is portrayed, as you'll see in a minute, in a sympathetic way. As a matter of fact, I'll show you something in a second. It's a long story that takes place among these noblemen in 1811, 1812, when they're already under Russia, and they're hoping Napoleon will show up and liberate them. And meanwhile, two families are fighting like crazy over a certain castle, as the Polish noble families do, and they're coming to blows. And meanwhile, there's a romance in there and all the rest of it. And you'll see in a second, these guys gather around in a bar. Because what do you do in the countryside? You know, that's the place. That's the Cracker Barrel. Get in a bar, and they're shooting the bull about Napoleon and the French and this and that and the other. And the Jews are serving, and they're playing. It's a Jewish place. I found it online. You would have seen that they're all doing their plotting, and they're talking about Napoleon and throwing over the Russians. And then the Jews all around, and at every point he says, give me more beer, and give me more of this, and let's play a tune. And the Jews are the ones who play the fiddle and the instruments as well. So they provide the local music. So let's put it this way. If it's a church wedding, so yeah, of course you have the wedding in the church. You have all the music over there. Then they come to have the party in the tavern. And the Jew will say, I'll give you one round for free. And they play the music and everybody's dancing. These are Goyim dancing Goyisha music. You understand? The Jews are playing it. I want to be clear about that, right? And that means the Jews hear all the Cracker Barrel politics. There are no secrets for them that they don't know. They're the musicians of choice at the rural Gentile weddings and things like that. At the end of the novel, or the play, poem actually, the one of the heroines, Polish girl, like a little stickle princess, a noble person, she goes to Jankel, and she says, will you play the Polish dance? He said, my hands don't work anymore. He said, nobody plays like you. And at the end, he does. And that's how they all dance away into their memories and things like that. In which case, what does it tell you? The author was not Jewish. I'll say it again. He was a Novartiker. Okay, but he wasn't Jewish. And he's from Novartik. And but he knows what life was like at that time. And the Jew is part of the scenery. Okay. Now, the Jew is not an actor. He's part of the furniture, you see? So it's a little bit like you see the Negro servants in the old White House. But not exactly. You see? But not exactly. Because you see, the Jews are their own culture. They're of service to the Poles, but they kind of get out of the way and let the Poles do all the actions. The Jews don't fight the wars. They don't plot the plots. They don't dream about, kicking out the Russians. But they're there. So I'm simply sharing this all with you to say, once upon a time, it was part of the warp and the woof. Is the other movie also not working?
The next one should work. This one's playing on that screen too.
Okay, well let's see. We'll try it. I even found a very recent movie, which I wouldn't recommend you seeing because you don't have a strong stomach. Called Volin, where Shuchman is from, and it's I'll talk about this later in next week. In the Second World War. At one point, in eastern Poland, which is kind of Ukrainian, Poles and Ukrainians live there, there was a series of massacres of the Poles by the Ukrainians in vicious ways. I mean, you're stabbing eyeballs out and you're ripping children in half and things like that. Yeah, really, I'm serious. Not Jews, it's the Ukrainians, the Poles. And the Poles made a movie about this recently. And the reason is because the Ukrainians and the Poles, as we'll see in a minute, always had a lot of bad relationships. Even a movie talking about 1939 is still a Jewish bartender. It's still at Jankel's Tavern, so to speak. The guy doesn't have a beard anymore. This is a very recent Polish movie, like last year. You understand? Yeah, that's right. And the Ukrainians are plotting to overthrow Poland and this and that and the other. And they're ordering the drinks from the Jew. They're bargaining with them for the price of the booze and all the rest of it until the Germans show up and they shoot him. Which means that what I just described to you lasted until the Holocaust. When the Holocaust came, I'm thinking everything came to an end. You know that. Germany just killed everybody. But all the way up to that time, this phenomenon that I'm talking about was all over the place, in places like Poland, Europe, even though people tried, governments tried to suppress it. But as I say again, all these things, we're looking at Jews in the countryside, which is the majority, in the cities, the burghers, the city people and the clergy had more of a say. Yeah, this is the priest who's trying to get, he's not really a priest, trying to get everybody to revolt. There's the owner of the tavern. He's trying to get him to say, Napoleon's coming, we're going to kick out the Russians. Napoleon. They're talking treason, you understand? The Jews just the furniture. Here's the players. There's the uncle who figures, hey, we're going to have a war. Yeah. We'll stop in a second. That was one. Were you able to get any of the others? Yeah. Here the guy's trying to heat everybody up. He said, let's go have a fight with the other noble family and kill them. You know, all these people are little nobles. Nobelach. You know, little, you know. Hey. He's the agitator. They're getting their anger up. These are all nobles at the local bar in front of it. See how they're trying to heat everybody up to join an expedition. Look at this, here comes a Jew. The voice of common sense. Napoleon's not coming till later anyway. See that? Nobody doesn't bother him. That's enough, yeah. So look at the Jew in the village, so to speak, right? Now he has an opinion, and by the way, he's right. Because in the end, you know, the Russians are going to win. Yeah. But he's part of the scenery. And by the way, the guy says just what Bill Sachs said. He said, you coward, shut up, this is not for Jews. I get that. Yeah, right, well, whatever. Yeah, you know, whatever. But who's the real fools, you know, the nobles or the Jew? You stand by the end of the story. Do you have the next one? This is at the wedding. She's going to ask him, will you play?
Umiem chodzić około domu, a umiem nosić klucze. Gospodarstwa
He's the only one. This is a Polish dance of the nobles. Jankiel. See, he has a reputation of being the only good. What is it called? Zither, yeah, dulcimer, yeah. So at the classic Polish noble dance, who's the band? Lucy Groves. You understand? Okay, that's enough. You know, it goes on and on. But you see the point. Now, some people said Mickiewicz is idealizing and all that. That's a whole machlokes in Polish literature. But nevertheless, it's, look at that. Now, does the next one work? 1939. Is it Ukrainian? Is a Jewish barkeeper again, tavern keeper. They're complaining about the Poles. They're bargaining over the price of booze. These are Ukrainians plotting against Poland. Translator to do a good job. So the Jewish barkeeper has to just see a lot and keep his mouth shut. You see, what? 1939, the Jews stole part of the furniture. By the way, that could be your uncle, your great uncle, or something like that. That's my point. Until the next one, when the Germans show up. Here they're taking a Jewish communist and hanging her. She was the communist teacher sent by Stalin. This is what the Germans did when they showed up everywhere in Eastern Europe. Wait a minute. He almost, and he feels bad about the bartender, but they tell him, they give him away. That was the end of the Jewish bartenders, because the end of all the Jews in Eastern Europe. So that's what I mean when I say the Jews are part of the countryside, part. You ran into them everywhere. That's my point, okay? Now, even in urban settings, the Jews, let me put it this way. everything I've been talking about Jews in the countryside, which is the majority in the cities, you had the clergy and the burghers had more of a say, and there were pogroms and things like that from time to time. It was worse. I remember in Vilna, there's a shul, main shul, where after the fifth or sixth hakafa, when Simchas started, they sat down and they did something like Eicha or something like that. It wasn't because they're misnagdim, but because they commemorated that once the Jesuits broke in with a bunch of college students and killed people in the sixth hakafa, back in the 1600s. That became like a custom. You know, so you had those kinds of things, because in urban areas, there was a larger concentration. But even there, the Jews could appeal to the magnate who owned the city. In Poland, most of the cities were owned by a guy. So you could talk to the guy who owned the place and say, Prince so-and-so, Count so-and-so, you know, we need law and order over here for things to do. Mayor Balaban, a famous historian, has all these records that he found where, you know, the Poles say the Jews can't move to Park Heights. And the Jews move to Park Heights anyway, you know, and the Jews can't buy houses in Forest Park. And they buy houses in Forest Park anyway because they get the magnate and the noble on their side. The bottom line is that the nobles provided effective protection in return for effective economic benefit to the nobles. From the point of view of the nobles, the Jews are one of their assets, like their animals, an intelligent steward who takes care of productive animals. You don't let them get away. This is from, I did this years ago, from the famous Polish novel about the Chmielnicki massacres with fire and sword. We see a magnate, one of the biggest ones, Jeremiah Vishnevetsky in the 1640s, who is fighting against the Cossacks who have risen up against him, and they try to flatter him and get him off the guard, but he's not falling for it. But the first thing you'll see he says is like this: let's get the women and the Jews out of here. Son of a gun. Okay, look for him. See, the magnate, he's not interested in what the Chmielnicki has to say to him. And he says, kill the guys. Even though we're the envoys, he says, kill them. And they say, how can you kill the envoys? He says, I can do it. This guy was the best friend of the Jews in the Cossack Wars. And the Jewish sources have it. Now wait a second. Hold him for a second. Bill's amazing. Now he takes counsel. Every magnate is like a little king. He has his own counselors. Watch this. One minute. See, he said, so he calls his lieutenant. Who he is? 1 second. In 1 second, take 300 men. Let's call my wife, the nobles, and the Jews to Zamosh. Because he's saving his animals. You understand? This is a classic case over here. Okay. I feel bad for Bill. So we're done. Now, believe me. By the way, the same thing happened, and many people know about the Chmielnicki massacres of 1640s. Same thing happened in the 1760s to the Heidemachs. Same thing, where the Ukrainians rose and they went crazy. And they kill. This is, you know, why is Nachman Breslov buried in Uman? Because the Jews of Uman had been, shortly before his death, exterminated by the Cossacks. You understand? Because they came over here. Here, look at this. The massacre of Uman in 1768, the Poles and the Ukraine Uniates, Heidemachs, the Cossacks, in a town of so-and-so, well-fortified town, made one of the primary targets of the Cossack movement, and season was planned in advance. A guy named Gonta was accused of wiping out the whole Jewish community beforehand. And anyway, they came there and they killed everybody. And Nachum Breslover lived not far away, and he said he wanted to be buried there in Uman, which is why everybody goes there now. So that's a place where the Ukrainians, like 100 years after Khmelnytsky, did another Khmelnytsky, and they came to this town, and they just lost it. They killed everybody in horrible ways. I don't know how many thousands of Jews. There's even, believe it or not, a epic poem of the Ukrainians by a guy named Shevchenko, in which he talks about all this, and the hero, or the protagonist, says, "We came to this town, we just killed everyone, we became animals, we don't even know what happened to us." You get it? So this is the problem. What happened over here? The nobles send an army and wipe them out. So once again, the Jews are always depending on these princes and these nobles. That's how it goes. We would prefer a narrative in which every Jew had a 22, but that wasn't realistic. You know, you'd say, why did the Jews arm themselves? They couldn't fight against it. They had to go on the depend on the noble armies. There were groups like the Shomrim and the JDL, believe it or not. There really were. There was a Jewish militia in a lot of places, all the rest of it. And shuls used to be built like fortresses, out of wood, though. But that's why you have all these famous shuls of Simchas Torah, where they can use the gunpowder that's stored at the bottom of the shul for hakafas, because that was standard in Poland once upon a time. If you ever go to Beit HaTfutzot, some of you know what I'm talking about, they have these models of these old, large, beautiful shuls that once existed. They're fortresses. Okay? But it's only fortunes against a local thing, not when an army comes. But these can only be temporary expedients. You know, you need, like, the next guy, Prince Jeremy, he's got an army. He was a magnate yourself before he had an army, so he could protect Jews and army. You can't do it without an army. One more piece of the pie, and that's religious toleration. This was a delicate issue in Polish-Lithuanian politics, religious toleration. Because the Protestant Reformation, believe it or not, made a lot of converts in Poland. This is interesting. In certain parts of Poland, the Jesuits determinedly and successfully over a long, long period of time converted most of the Protestant nobles, well, not all, through a Kiruv program, because the Jesuits are famous for the end justifies the means. They're very good at that. Not through violence. So you didn't have in Poland burning of heretics or anything like that. It's interesting. A Spanish-Portuguese mentality is foreign to Poland, and all that's good for the Jews. Just wasn't part of the way they operated. They shacked and burned people for having a different religious belief. Kiruv, though, was always there. Notice they always want to convert the Jew. In the old kingdom of Poland that I'm talking about, if a Jew, I couldn't believe it, if a Jew converted, he immediately became a nobleman. That was incentive, get it? That's a good deal. You see, it's a good deal. It's, I don't want to say the joke. Anyway, no time for that. The Jesuit Counter-Reformation, which is the Catholic Reformation, expended most of its energy on the Protestants and on the Greek Orthodox, trying to convert them to Catholic. This left the Jews rather untouched. You know, not totally, but rather untouched. It was a million times better than the other Catholic countries of Europe at that time. Austria, Italy, Spain, Portugal, my goodness, it was terrible. And finally, you had the baby boom. With all this countryside stuff that I'm talking about, the Jews, nobody knows exactly why, but Poland is the only place where the Jews had a baby boom, a significant expansion of the population in the 1500s, in the 1600s, in the 1700s, and in the 1800s. Okay? Until it got to a point where Polish Jewry, no, I mean Eastern European Jewry, because when I say Poland, once again, I'm talking about Lithuania, Ukraine, Belarus, you know, all those to Poland itself, Galicia, but taken as a whole, there's the only Jewish community I know of in history of the diaspora that I know of. We had a significant population expansion. In Germany, you had the same number of Germans generation after generation. Italy, Spain, this and the other, generation after generation. Sometimes there's a little immigration in there. Poland, from their own efforts, grew and grew. So something must have worked over there. And that's why everybody here comes from Poland, from Eastern Europe. Because at one time or another, when it comes to 1800s, they started leaving, whether they went to America or South Africa or to England, to wherever they went. They had so many Jews as a surplus to send out and still have plenty of people left back in there. It's the only community like that. So with all the crazy stuff that I'm sharing with you tonight, it must have worked somehow or other because the Jews took off, okay? Now to politics. The Jews are an important part of Poland starting 1500s. Poland fell apart around the late 1700s. So the good years of Poland before it fell apart are about 200 or 300 years. From 1500 to 1648, things were great for the Jews and the Poles. That's what I was talking about. But there were structural problems in the house that were not being seen to, and that's never a wise policy for a homeowner if you have leaks. And first of all, you have the weak central government with the liberum veto, as they call it. By the time you get to the late 1500s, the nobles pass a law, the magnates especially, no law can get passed in Congress unless it's unanimous. Right? That's right, exactly. Liberum veto. Anybody can say I veto it, you know, free veto. Right? So how's that going to work? This made sure, of course, that you'll never pass a law that David Katz doesn't like. Right? That's the idea behind it. You know, that depend me. This made sure that the kingdom had all the disadvantages of a monarchy and all the disadvantages of a republic, not the advantages. There was no strong executive, so structurally you have a problem. Who can run the government? Who fights the wars? Who makes sure that there's enough money in the treasury and all that? None of that. There's no strong military in the wealthiest country in Europe. That's real dumb. This guy was a great hero, King Stefan Batory. He beat the Russians, he beat the others. He's always fighting on the cheap, like George Washington. Why? He was the king of the richest country in the world, or richest country in Europe. Shouldn't have been like that. You understand? But they always chintzed him out, and nobody would give any money, and he was always living hand to foot, and this is how it went. The nobles could not help but put themselves first ahead of their country. If there was to be an advantage, if it was to their advantage, they would make a deal with a foreign country against the interests of Poland. That's just who they were. Happened over and over again. There were long interregnums between kings. That was a big problem. This happened disastrously in 1648. When the Cossacks rose up to the surprise of the Poles, the king died at that very moment. It took them, I don't know how many months, 6-8 months to elect a new king. Till then, Poland shut down. So the Cossacks can run around crazy and kill everybody, and Poland couldn't get an army together to fight it, except these local magnates like you saw in the picture before. You know, Prince Jeremy fought with his own army. Foreign princes always tried to get the Polish throne for their own good. In other words, I forgot to tell you this. Part of the deal was, is elective monarchy. Every time the king dies, you have to elect a new one. Okay, where's that going in terms of bribery? Where's that going in terms of foreigners who want to become king of Poland for their own sake, right? Not for patriotic Polish purposes, for their aggrandize, not for the good of the country. The nobility, the Shlachta, and the magnates, here's another problem, were too cruel to the Ukrainians on both the religious as well as the economic and political level. So in the Eastern Poland with the Ukrainians, like you saw in the bars, They persecuted the churches, they beat up the people, they raped the women, they did all kind of bad things. And that means you have a giant population that's seething with discontent. It's never too smart. In 1648, therefore, they erupted a series of disasters which the kingdom should have been ready for but wasn't, and it lasted 30 years. 30 years. You had a Cossack uprising, like we saw before. I don't know if you can have the picture of it, but it's late, so I won't throw you the movies. There was a big Cossack uprising, which destroyed several Polish armies. Then there was a lot of atrocities on both sides. In other words, the Cossacks wiped out and nailed the crosses over the Poles when they found them, and vice versa. Okay? This Prince Jeremy became famous because if he came to a village, here's a Swedish invasion, that's another thing. If he came to a village where he saw Tolleson's villain, he said, they killed the Jews, wipe out the village. You understand? Now, that's how it was savage. So then Sweden decided to invade. Sweden was a major power at that time. And look at this huge army invading Poland out of nowhere. And a Polish historian I saw the other day said that the Swedes did more damage to Poland than the Germans did in World War II. Right? So it's just unbelievable. Then the Russians invaded, because why not? Then the Turks invaded, because why not? In the 1670s, here's the Ottoman Turkish army. Look at that. Going to the famous fortress of Kamenets-Podolski, which was the frontier bastion of Poland against the Turks. Then you have all these atrocities. Here's the Turks in a very famous, this is the Polish gone with the wind, you know, it's a three-part. No, I'm serious, Sienkiewicz, you know. But the point is, he takes the Barbara, the girl who thought that he was a friend of the Poles, and he shechs the father in front of her. 1600s, after all the death and suffering, there was recovery and renewal. Because finally, Poland got a normal king, a very great king, John Sobieski, one of the great heroes of Europe and of Poland militarily. And he was a PhD. That's right. So he was a great general, and he also had an advanced degree from university. You don't find that too often anywhere, particularly in Poland. And he was a member of the Shlachta, of course. Here again is a very famous, you can turn the sound off, we just showed the thing. He's it's after a hero has blown himself up in a fortress. So he's saying, they're making a whole speech, and Sobieski, the great general, is going to come in, and he's going to, you'll see in a second, here you go. And he said, enough for speeches, let's pull out the swords. And the sword of the guy who broke his own sword when he blew up the fortress, not to surrender to the Turks. He holds it up as a symbol, you know. It was a great friend of the Jews, because the intelligent kings valued the Jews. So yes. Anyway, you see, he has a whole thing, and they all pull out their swords. Renewal and recovery for the Jews. After all the terrible things that happened to Gezeres Tachmatat that we covered years ago, the horrible suffering of the Jews, life moved on. In other words, it was a 40 years to live, 1648 to about 30 years to live in, and then it was over, so to speak. And the other ethnic groups left Poland. They said, this place is crazy. So the Jews are the only ones left. So they have all the stores. They have all the money lending operations. They have all the sort of thing under the nobles. You see? So the Jews have monopoly in economic things. This is the law of unintended consequences. Sobieski was a great man, was prevented from carrying out the necessary reforms during his reign. He helped the Jews a lot. When he died at the end of the century, Poland, always rich in resources, was poor in intelligent statecraft. Its nobles were selfish and irresponsible, and in the next century, which I'll do next time, they would run the resource-rich but politically backwards kingdom into the ground. So the irony of this is, I leave you tonight with the message, that this very group of irresponsible noblemen and noblewomen were the best friends of the Jews, for better or worse. That's the crazy quilt history of the Jews when you get to Poland. Under this republic of noblemen, the Jews developed the largest and freest Jewish community anywhere. When I say free, I mean the Jews were more free to be as Jewish as they wished. And the Jews took full advantage of this. No wonder the Jews called it Poland. This is the place we rest. The problem was that this support for the Jews was confined to the nobles, as long as they were the only ones who counted, well and good. But a day would come when the other 90% of the population would have a say in the nation's governance. How would this 90% of the react to the presence of such a large and noticeable non-Polish minority group scattered throughout the land, often controlling significant parts of the economy? This was a very uncomfortable question, as we will see. But while it lasted, right, Poland was better than just about anywhere else. Good night.